Yes. What is general things? Well, what is known? Sources for electricity, electrical energy generation. First of all, it is well known that electrical power generation is the key factors for advances in any other industries, agriculture, and level of living. And each of these statements I will prove with some slides. Now, eventually, we have two large groups that will be of energy source. Will be non-renewable, such as coal, natural gas, oil, and nuclear, and renewable, such as hydro, wind, solar, biomass, geothermal, and marine. Marine means tidal and wave power. However, in spite of so many different energy sources which currently used in the world, the primary one will be thermal, and number one will be coal, secondary natural gas. I'm talking about the world. And a little bit oil use, number two hydro, and number three nuclear. The rest of energy source might have visible impact, yes, in some countries, but many of them depends on mother nature, plus relative cost of electrical energy generated by this and some other renewable sources, with exception of large hydroelectric power plants, can be significantly higher than those generated by non-renewable sources. What we have here? Here is a table in our publications and on in internet. You can find the whole HDI, means Human Development Index. At the left bottom, you can see a very simple equation, what means HDI. It's consists of cubic root of multiplication of life expectancy index, education index, and income index. And all countries in the world, they have, according to these calculations, ranks. Now, what we have as of today, no, eventually it's 2018, because you never can get the latest data. Norway number one, and this is actual calculation, it will be 0.957 index. And also, I would like to link the how we living in the country, level of living and everything, with the electrical energy consumption. To the right, we have EEC, electric energy consumption, data from 2018-2019. One is watts per capita, means watts per person in a country, and second one, total generation in a country or consumption in a country by gigawatts hour. Why is consumption? Because it can be that some country export energy, it will be minus, some country import energy, and it will be plus, but you're talking about consumption inside country by people, industry, agriculture, and everything there. We have four groups. Four groups that will be very high HDI, 65 countries. Russia in this group and will be on number 52 by rank. And after that will be high HDI, it will be 53 countries, world at on average at rank 99. And medium HDI, many countries, but I just decided to show the second largest by population, India. It will be 131st place. And after that will be countries with low HDI, 33 countries. And if you look at the watts per capita, for example, Chad, it's only 2 watts per capita. Can you imagine what the people in this country can do? They can do absolutely nothing. No computers, no lights. It's less than flashlight can provide you such power per person. No, of course, it's not uniformly distributed because majority of the people are sitting without any lights at all. Because it's almost a dead end for development. There is no industry developed, no agriculture. No education, because it's really, really bad things. In terms of electrical energy consumption in watts per capita, it's interesting, I think that I have here, number four. It will be Iceland, and Iceland is unbelievably high. It's almost 6 kilowatt per person. No one is even very close, no one country in the world. The closest one will be Norway. It's 2,648 watts per person. And after that, some countries which go into the very high rank. In Russia, it will be 763. Well, definitely, there is a room of improvement and higher consumption. It will be a better level of living in the country. Here is, I have correlated human development index versus electrical energy consumption, and you can see that we have very strong dependence. It's all countries in the world. Unfortunately, I can only point it out selected countries, which will be summer to the sides. If you look at the right corner, you can see, I will say this like correlation to success, accuracy plus minus 20% in all countries there. Due to this, if you would like to be in a group of very high HDI, approximately you need to have something like 400, 500 watts per person in the country. This is proof of what I said, where you have lights, you have very developed civilization. Where you have no lights or there is no people, like for example, Canadian North, Alaska. But in many countries like Africa, you can see it's very few lights, mainly northern part and south. And this is from 400 satellite images from NASA. How countries and world generate electricity? I pick up countries with, first of all, by large population. After that, countries which generate a lot of energy, so nuclear, of course, different sources like hydro. Let's see for the world. What will be left upper part? We still heavily rely on coal, generally in the world. It's 36.7%, natural gas or liquefied natural gas, 23.5%. Third number will be hydro, 15.8%. Fourth place, nuclear, 10.4%. I would like to say that Fukushima nuclear power plant severe accident significantly put down the nuclear power industry. We dropped down from 14.4% because we lost 4% in world generation of electricity. Well, after that, will be from renewables after hydro wind, 5.3%, a little bit solar, 2.7%, still in some countries oil use, 3.1%, and 2.5% other. If you look at such countries with the largest population, in red is population in millions. Because currently in the world we have 7,871,000,000 people. In China, 1,439,000,000. China doing a lot of efforts to decrease dependence on coal, which is their natural fuel inside country. With hydro, nuclear, wind, solar, a little bit gas, but still it's 62.2%. Second source, hydro, 17.7%. After that, wind, 5.5%, nuclear, 4.8%, and a little bit gas, solar, and other. India, as the second largest country by population, it's 1,380,000. Even more heavily rely on coal, is 71%. A little bit hydro, 11%, gas 4.5, wind 4.1, and some other sources. Surprisingly, the United States, in spite of all advances in many industries, they still rely on coal partially. It will be 24.2%, but in recent years they started to use more gas, and they have gas electricity generation 37.4%. They also paying attention to renewables, and they have wind 7, hydro 7, a little bit geothermal, biomass, and of course they have around 19.3% nuclear, which is large their sector. And the United States, later on I will discuss this, they have the largest number of nuclear power reactors in the world. Brazil enjoying hydro at 63.5%. Wind 9%, biomass 9%, little bit coal, little bit gas 10%, also nuclear, but nuclear and solar, it's almost not visible, 2.6 and 1.1%. Russia mainly rely on gas, but still some coal use around 16%, hydro 17.5%, nuclear around 19%, and a little bit oil. Japan, of course, before the Fukushima, if I'm not mistaken, Japan had around 30% electricity generated in the country from nuclear. Now it's dropped down to only 6.4%. Mainly they rely on gas, slightly less on coal, a little bit solar, hydro, and some other energy sources. Germany heavily rely on coal and also on renewables, a little bit on gas, and even smaller for nuclear. Eventually, I don't know that they will have election this year. Who will be in power? They would like eventually to shut down all nuclear power plants which are left. But still, they have to figure out how to cover this 12.1% of electricity generation. In UK, they almost eliminated coal. They heavily rely on gas, 17% nuclear, wind 20%, and also solar, hydro, and biomass. If you go into France, France is the one country which 70% rely on nuclear, which is really good, 11% hydro, a little bit gas, almost no coal, and after that a little bit solar and biomass. Italy, non-nuclear country, because they have a whole variety of different sources, but still they mainly rely on gas and also hydro, wind, because they have also quite large piece of this pie from renewables. South Korea mainly on coal, in spite of all advances in nuclear power. They are still quite solid on that. They have 24.7 generation by nuclear, 27 by gas, and some other sources. Spain, mainly gas and nuclear and wind. Ukraine, 55% nuclear and 31% coal. Poland, unfortunately, very heavy rely on coal, 74%. It is currently Poland looking for nuclear to build nuclear power plants. Canada enjoying hydro resources, 58%, but also 15.5% nuclear and gas. Sweden, nuclear and hydro, the major ones. In this country, also wind, quite significant, 12%. And the last country which I would like to show to you, Iceland. It's a very small country in terms of people. It's only 340,000 people, but possibly it's one of the very few countries which purely depends on renewables, as hydro and geothermal. This is in table form, these things. Also, it just came idea to me yesterday to check. The basic idea is that when we're talking about global warming and everything, if you look at several countries at the top, this is countries put by the highest level of generation of electricity in these countries. World, 23,000 terawatts hour. China actually 7, it's 1/3. United States around 4,000. India, 1,500, and Russia, I'm sorry, it's a mistake, it should be 965, because it's decreasing. What this means? It means that actually only several countries in the world control huge pollutions of CO2 into atmosphere from power industry. Well, of course, it will be China, India, partially USA, because approximately 800 grams of CO2 per kilowatt of energy. And if it will be gas-fired power plants, it will be twice less, it will be around 400. What is interesting, why are we talking about that renewables are not so reliable? And this is a very interesting example, what could happen in UK. Possibly in our times, so we have quite significant changes of climate, which can be different patterns. It can be very unusual events, like in Moscow, what I heard, very strong rains in Crimea, very strong rains, many other places, fires, and so on. Here is three quarters from 2015, 16, 17, and after that 1 week of 2017, right bottom corner, what had happened? They moved almost out from using coal from 2015. But within a week of January 16 to 22, it's unbelievable, the above whole UK, no winds at all. Due to this, if you look at the Q3 2017, they had around 90% wind plus solar, this power gone for the whole week. What you will do? Hydro is very small. they have a very shallow rivers and not so many. Nuclear operating as much as possible. They were lucky that they didn't shut down completely or destroy coal-fired power plants. You can see that during this week, the whole grid was saved by coal, and it's increased from 3% to 18%. This means that when you have a reasonable amount of renewables, you still have to worry about what will happen if they will disappear due to, for example, clouds for solar energy, or, for example, there is no winds or something like that. It's quite dangerous things which we can see there. But this is sources which I have used. It's up to you. Table show the largest power plants of the world. Vast majority of them, it's actually dams. The largest dam or power plant which we know it will be in China, the gorgeous dam, 22,500 megawatts installed capacity. The largest nuclear power plant, it will be number 9, Kashiwazaki-Kuriwa. Unfortunately, after Fukushima, it's not in service. Due to this, currently, the largest operating nuclear power plant in the world is in Canada, Bruce, with 6,288 megawatts installed capacity. And after that, some also hydro plants. The largest wind plant will be Gansu in China. Jebel Ali, it will be natural gas in the United Arab Emirates. What I would like also to bring your attention, usually you know that efficiency or thermal efficiency is extremely important, especially for power plants. But usually it's not very well propagated to general people that we have another very important parameter, which is capacity factor. Capacity factor means how much installed capacity, full installed capacity per year can be used or is used. Of course, we have some artificial things, like, for example, coal-fired, gas-fired power plants, the following peaks and drops in consumption of electricity per day and per year. Due to this, they artificially introduce capacity factors, but look at the natural things. Three gorges dam, unbelievable dam. It's only 52%. And usually for hydro, it's around 40% in the world. It doesn't matter what you will do, this is where you will get maximum from your installed capacity. Wind also from 20 to 40%, but I have no data for Gansu because it's relatively a new plant. But if you look at Bruce, number 16, like many nuclear power plants, it's 100%, or if it will be older one, it's 90%, no, in particular Bruce, for quite a long time, it's 87% capacity factor. For two, at the bottom, it will be from South Korea. They have 93% and 92% of capacity factors. This is all energy sources which we have and the largest power plants which I have found. Mainly we have hydro, natural gas, wind, coal, nuclear, fuel oil, but still thermal. We have three types of hydro plants. It will be run of the river without not very large artificial lake behind. It can be a hydroelectric pump storage, but usually sometimes they taking energy from the grid, not returning back. Biomass, still thermal, solar, photovoltaic, oil shale thermal, geothermal, peat, thermal, wind, offshore means you have inland or in the shallow waters of the sea or ocean. Internal combustion engines, solar, concentrated solar, tidal, diesel, concentrated photovoltaic, recovered energy, and marine waves. Here is thermal efficiency of thermal and nuclear power plants. Top one will be combined cycle power plants, gas-fired, and up to 62% because they have double cycle, they have at a higher level of temperature breaking gas turbine cycle and at lower end Rankine steam turbine cycle. Why is important to look at these things? Because generation 4 reactors, to have relatively high thermal efficiencies, possibly will go with the same idea to use breaking gas turbine cycle, for example, with helium or helium nitrogen, and after the trend can cycle, otherwise with single cycle, it's not easy to get to such high efficiency. Second level will be supercritical pressure coal-fired power plants, even internal combustion engines, diesel cycle and the Otto cycle, high efficiency are up to 50% subcritical pressure, older coal-fired power plants 43%, and the top nuclear power plants equipped with carbon dioxide cooled reactors, 14 of them left in UK, it's up to 42%. Because eventually using the same Rankine cycle as older coal-fired power plants. Two Russian reactors, sodium cool fast reactors, up to 40%. They slightly have less pressure and less temperature compared to AGRs. Below will be pressurized water reactors. It's the most important reactor because the largest one in the world right now. Up to 36-38%, older models are like generation 3, 34-36, boiling water reactors around 34, pressurized water reactors, majority of which will be CANDU type, Canada, deuterium, uranium reactors 32, and after that two SMRs, small modular reactors, it will be the latest generation 3 plus rhythm 200M. It's not yet in operation as a nuclear power plant, but it will decision made and it will be built in Yakutia. But the number 12, it will be KLT-40S, and it's already to these reactors on a barge and barge station in Port Quebec, and they produce electricity there. No, this is a coal-fired power plant, one of the largest ones. It's the most significant polluters of the air with CO2. Also, it's a lot of ash and slag, and even radioactivity going out with coal into it, but still people living nearby, which is not so good. Here is a comparison of various ways. And you can see number 9 is radioactive waste. Of course, absolutely cannot say that it's okay. It should not be radioactive waste because some of them are going for hundreds or even thousands of years and they are very, very dangerous. But by total percent, in total amount of all waste, it's the minimum. The largest one will be the mining and the quarry. Comparison between supercritical pressure coal-fired power plant and, for example, pressurized water reactor and boiling water reactor. One unit which we have in Canada, it's approximately net 450 megawatts electrical, gross 490, means that 40 megawatts used inside plant, requires 1.8 million tons of coal annually. This is a huge amount. And this power plant built near the open pit mine, and by conveyors, day and night, coal went directly to this plant. In this case, for 2.5, almost three times larger pressurized water reactor, 1300 megawatts electrical, you need only 115 tons of 3.2 enrichment uranium, or if it will be a boiling water reactor, which will be less enrichment, it will be 170 tons. Here is also another comparison nuclear power plant to the left, in terms of emissions and coal fire. As you can see, that fuel definitely very small for nuclear power plant waste. It's huge amount, it's 6,500 tons of CO2 for 1,000 megawatts plant. For nuclear plant, we have 35 tons of high-level waste, 300 tons of intermediate-level radioactive waste, and 460 tons of low-level waste. But for coal-fired power plants, we have significantly higher numbers for any waste. This is a carbon footprint. Upper one going coal, gas, biomass, solar, marine, hydro, wind, and the last one is nuclear. Of course, nuclear not emitting CO2 during operation, but if you look at the lower graph, we're talking about full cycle. For coal, for example, it's a building mine, taking coal, bringing to the plant, burning, and demolition also. Due to this, for nuclear power plants, the largest one carbon footprint will be extraction of ore, uranium dioxide, The second one will be construction, decommissioning, a little bit operation, and so on. But still, compared to all other sources, this is the minimum carbon footprint. Oh, just for fun, this is one of the diesel generators in India. I have mentioned that they can use it for also electricity generation in a grid. This is, for my opinion, the largest diesel generator. You can see it's actually a five-story building or five-story diesel generator. It's 50 megawatts electrical, four of them in a grid. Possibly it's not very large city, and they work. But efficiency of such diesel generators are around 50%, not like in a truck or a car. This is Kashiwazaki Kuriwa power plant in Japan. Officially, it's the largest one with more than 8,000 megawatts electrical, but currently not in operation. What also is interesting, it was at the site where the first generation 3+ reactors have been built in 1996 and 1997. It was advanced boiling water reactors, and this is what you can see on this photo. This is our Canadian Bruce nuclear power plant. There is two major parts, Bruce A far away and Bruce B nearby. And also to the left is a historical part, it's one of the first nuclear power plants in Canada, which is called Douglas Point. But of course now it's decommissioned, but still as memorial is nice to have on this site. Now, hydroelectric plants, as I have mentioned, it can be of three types. This is regular one, a large lake, and possibly on some river. This is photo of the largest in the world dam or hydroelectric power plant in China. It's unbelievable power. Most interesting things that, of course, it's not cheap. The project cost $26 billion, but the length of the dam 2.4 kilometers. With such power, I will tell you roughly that in 2.4 kilometers, there is 22 nuclear reactors by 1,000 megawatts should be installed. Just to understand what is comparison of this hydro plant to, for example, regular nuclear power plant with one reactor of 1,000 megawatts. They have a lake of 39 cubic kilometers, and please remember that in spite of these huge things, the capacity factor only around 50%. This is run of the river. It's a quite rare power plant. You see there is no very large artificial lake upstream, but it's using maybe some nature where you have some significant drop in levels of water. This is from the United States. The problem is with hydro. You cannot build anywhere. You have to have very special places where you can get to build a large hydro plant. No, for example, like in UK, I think that they used everything. You cannot increase at this part. In Germany, they used everything what will be reasonable. You cannot increase this part because it depends on mother nature and the special allocations. So this is hydro pumping stations. Operation is interesting. You don't need to have any river going through. You have upper lake, lower lake. During daytime from upper lake is operating as regular plant at night, because in many countries the price for electrical energy at night dropping down quite substantially. Turbine used as a pump and generator used as electrical motor. Station pumping water from lower lake to upper one. But due to this, for the year it will be more energy used from the grid than returned back through generation, but due to a difference in prices there exist in many countries. But it's not so popular. This is largest in the world wind power plant in China, Gansu. It's unbelievable size in terms of kilometers covered by that. Now also, if you're not dealing with wind energy, you're always thinking, oh, it's very light and very small, for example, room near the blades where it's everything rotating there. But I brought some data here. Now, first of all, the total mass, if it will be only 2.5 megawatts installed capacity, is 340 tons. To the right on the bottom, this is from Rosatom, You have to have such huge foundation, very heavy one, that due to winds and everything, that such tower can withstand these winds. What is interesting, of course, everywhere almost we have winds, but the problem is that with the vast majority of modern turbines, you have to have minimum 6 meters per second per year of the winds. If not, there is no point to build any wind power plant. This is map of United States, where is green and yellow and slightly brown. It's all below 6 meters per second. Because in United States, only in the central part where we have very strong winds, there is point to build wind plants. How wind power plant operate? And this is what means unreliable. You can see that eventually this is 650 megawatts installed capacity plant in shallow waters near Denmark. It's following the sun activity. It is from 8 o'clock to 20, you have the highest one, but you never can predict what will be the next day. You can have up to 500 megawatts, or you can get as low as maybe 50. This is what means unreliable energy sources. But this is a comparison between a nuclear power plant and onshore. Carbon set approximately the same, but energy density 7.5 less for a wind farm, and reliability less also more than four times. A couple interesting things. I know that Alstom, a French company, they already moved to 6 megawatts electrical wind turbine. This is monster, rotor diameter 150 meters and tower height 100 meters. But there are two proposals from Mitsubishi Heavy Industries. It will be 10 megawatt, and Siemens Gamesa, it will be 10 megawatts. It's a rotor diameter almost 200 meters. It's a huge one. The advantage of such huge turbines is that they can operate even if it will be a wind speed of 3 meters. Also, there is maximum speed around 90 kilometers. After that, you have to put brakes, that it will not be operational. Well, when we're talking about solar, this is again United States. Where you have to get solar? You're going south, you're going to desert. When you're going to north, of course, less efficient. When you're going in areas where you have a lot of clouds, rains, and everything, also efficiency drop quite significantly. This is one of the largest concentrated solar thermal power plant, three towers, heat exchanger, water heated there, and eventually it's at the bottom it's supercritical pressure thermal power plant. What is problematic with this one? First of all of these heliostats, they following sun by operated by computer. You have to always clean all the surfaces, which is not easy. Also, this is more or less desert. There is winds, flying stones, and everything. They damaging these heliostats. It was absolutely possibly unpredictable case which related to this plant. I cannot tell you to which tower. It was a computer glitch, and computer lowered all beams below the heat exchanger, and they burned this tower. I don't know, it was several years ago, I don't know if they repaired or not, but believe me, if it will not be very significant support from governments to solar and wind, they cannot compete. It's too expensive and too unreliable. But this is the most advanced plant in Spain. What do they have? They can operate, previous plant cannot operate 24 hours per day, because at night no sun is not operating. But in Spain, they using double loop. In primary loop, they're using molten salt. This molten salt can be stored during day time, and after that used for electricity generation at night. However, in winter time, they cannot cover 2 hours of operation, as I said, still. But the capacity factor is very high, 75%. This is another type of solar plants. It's like concave mirrors. But you can see how many mirrors damaged by flying debris. They have to replace, if I'm not mistaken, several thousand mirrors per year. Because even operation is not so cheap. But this is photovoltaic. This is in Germany. To be honest, I cannot agree with that. possibly it was definitely forest there, but now all fields covered with very inefficient power plants. But why? Because government paying a lot of money, which above what they paying to any other electricity generating sources. I agree to put, for example, on a roof, on a parking lot, it's okay because it's already used surface, but definitely not to, to take out forest fields and everything for this plant. This is operation in the same way as with winds. You cannot predict what will be tomorrow, and it's more or less like upside down parabolic shape. This is a location of hydrothermal size. Of course, geothermal energy is everywhere. However, the problem is how deep hot layers of the earth you can find. Due to this, like in the United States, at Yellowstone Park, where it's caldera of ancient volcano and everything, it will be the best place, but also some other places exist. But eventually, it's still operational, especially like in Iceland, but in many other countries, it's not too many geothermal plants built. This is different types of plants, simple diagrams for that. This is tidal. This is French River. Of course, tides almost everywhere in the ocean, but the case is that you have to find special place where you have the highest tide. You just hit very, very few places. What is interesting, there are some talks in Russia that there is a dam, I think it's in the Okhotsk Sea, and it can be up to 80,000 megawatts electrical installed capacity. But again, there are, of course, a lot of problems. No, first of all, ecology, how it will be okay with that. And second one, where to get all this energy. And there is no such large cities or anything nearby that to use it. What I have read, there is a proposal that to generate hydrogen and after that sell as environmental friendly fuel. But again, it's just a project. I don't think that anything done there. So this is power plants for the titles. You can see it's very few of them in the world. This is another plants related that this is power plants with waves. Now, of course, you have to remember that the major problem with all renewables except large hydro, it's very sparse energy. You have to cover huge territories for wind, for solar, for marine and everything, for waves power to get at least something from that. So this is what it means. They have cylinders floating in the sea, and all movement of the cylinders transfers through hydraulic to rotate a generator. But again, maximum, I think it's maybe 2 megawatts, but capacity factor is maybe 20% or something like that. But of course, the last one will be recovered energy generation. For example, like a small steam generator has heat exchange installed in a duct with a large amount of flue gases, for example, metallurgical plant, the glass melting plant. But of course, their power is really small due to this. A source we can consider, but not much details we can provide for that. What is interesting, how different sources operating in the grid. This is province of Ontario, one of the largest one in Canada. It's year 2012, population 13.4 million. We have more or less closed grid. We're not sharing too much energy importing or exporting. To the left is installed capacity. At that time, we had 31% nuclear, 24% gas, 21% hydro, 17% coal, and 7% wind, biomass, and solar, mainly wind, of course. However, what is interesting, how the electrical energy generated? 55% nuclear, 25% hydro. And of course, everybody would like to use coal as minimum because due to very significant pollution in atmosphere. Due to 17% installed capacity, only 7 use. From hydro, 21 installed, 25 use. No, here you cannot use more than it will be installed. And gas also operating with variable loads to cover peaks and drops. Here is hot day, June 19th, Tuesday, 2012, and how grid operating. To the left is actual generation of electricity to the right capacity factor. As you see, green line. Nuclear, 100% capacity factor almost with no changes. This is basic power which required for the province. After that, we have increase for electricity demand from 6-7 o'clock. Unfortunately, wind decreasing, red line. What we have to do? We have to increase power by gas. We have to increase significantly power by coal from 100 megawatts to almost 3,000 megawatts. We can increase hydro, but hydro always some limits due to eventually the grid regulated mainly by gas and coal. This is the major things for this grid. What we have currently, Ontario completely eliminated coal-fired power plants. They move, transferred some of them to gas, old one was closed. To the left, installed capacity, nuclear 32, gas 26, hydro 23, wind 12, solar 6.3 and biofuel 1%. And to the right, eventually how energy generate 61% nuclear, 24.5% hydro, no coal, a gas 6.4, wind 7.4, a little bit solar and biofuel. Now this is approximately the same trends as before, but there is no coal. Again, you see wind is unpredictable. During daytime when you really need a lot of energy, and this is a hot day, summer, July 17th, it's a drop down. Solar is upside down parabolic trend. Due to this, grid regulated by gas, a little bit hydro, and a little bit biofuel, but biofuel has not too much installed capacities. Here is summarized table for capacity factors. As I said, nuclear power plants is number one in this case. Of course, thermal power plants also can be with high capacity factors if you have supply of fuel and you have no damages of any equipment, but they use to regulate increase or decrease in energy consumption. If it will be geothermal in the United States, maybe 76%, bioenergy 51-75%, combined cycle 55% because they regulate the changes. Coal also in the same way. Hydroelectric, world average 45%. Of course, if it will be large like small plant, you can get 99%, but it's quite unusual. Wind, world from 20-40%. And other, of course, solar, it doesn't matter which thermal solar or photovoltaic, very depends on location. Here is a very sad slide because here I put together the casualties in the various industries. I don't know if you thought about that, but the most dangerous in our life is to drive a car. Look at these red numbers annually. It's not like good year or bad year, like for example, in aircraft casualties. 1,350,000 is huge city. People disappear from this earth due to death in car accidents. Moreover, 50 million people, it's number five below, became invalid annually in the world. This is huge. And we cannot decrease substantially this number. Of course, shipwrecks also in world around 3,174. Railway accidents also. For example, in India, it's not so small. It's 24,000 per year. Air accidents, this is the safest mode of operation. And it's a good year or bad year. For example, in 2020, we had only 9 accidents and only 137 people died. Of course, it's terrible, but compared to other possibilities, it's the smallest number. Of course, the most significant deaths, including what were people who died after this terrorist attacks in the United States, it was more than 4,500. In 1972, it was very bad year for air travel, like 3,344 people died. What is about power plant, hydropower plants, if they save They safe until the dam will not collapse. No, for example, a very famous case, Veyen Dam in Italy. It was one of the highest one. 2,000 people died in 1963. A piece of rock dropped down into the lake. Dam withstand, but it was artificial tsunami, and a lot of water going above the dam, and 2,000 people were washed in Italy during night. Of course, more recently we had Saryana-Sushenska hydroplant accident, 75 people died. One of the largest accidents with dams possibly will be Bankiao Dam in China in 1975. I don't think that it was a power plant, but still it was dams, more than 26,000. It was planes and dams collapsed due to torrential rains, and the water wave was around 5-7 meters, moving for 10 or so kilometers. It was almost no one can survive. What about nuclear? No, of course, the largest accident which known, it will be Chernobyl nuclear power plant. No, officially 56 people died right away during very high level of radiations. After that, I don't think that anybody in the world can say how many people died, because it's different reasons can be for that. No, also was famous Kishtim radiation release accident in Chelyabinsk, around maybe more than 200 people died. This is deaths per terawatt hour. If you're talking whole cycle, coal number one, oil, biomass, peat, gas, hydro, solar, wind, and the lowest one will be nuclear. No, of course, question is, this is like last slide for the first part, what to do? I will tell you that possibly each country or maybe a large region has to decide what is the best. Definitely will be some energy mix. You cannot just rely on nuclear power plants because it's not a good idea to regulate very fast level of power there. This definitely should be nuclear power plants as basis, after that renewables, but also some plants which can do fast response for the changes in industry. Now we're moving to nuclear power plants. Current problem, the vast majority of the nuclear power plants, except it's currently 443 in the world, two in Russia, sodium cooled fast reactors, and 14 in UK, carbon dioxide cooled reactors. The rest is water cooled, or 49 from them is heavy water cooled. The problem is that we're using saturated steam at inlet to the turbine for all nuclear power plants. This is standard. For advanced gas cooled reactors and sodium cooled fast reactors, we have superheated steam at in due to their efficiency is high. Why this so? No, first of all, pressurized water reactors, they're sitting at relatively high pressures, 15.5, 16 megapascal inside reactor. But problem is, if this is left graph, you can see that with increasing pressure, the saturation temperature leveled off. You test with a significant increase, you will not get a significant increase in temperature. Second one, the lower bottom left, the critical heat flux, which you always have to worry about for water-cooled reactors, it's dropping down very fast. Due to this, what I know, even coal-fired power plants, they will not go beyond 16, 17 megapascal. If you would like to increase your efficiency, the only choice to go to the supercritical pressures, minimum 23.5 and maximum 38, but only maybe a couple coal-fired power plants working at such a high pressures. Well, and to the right, and this is explanation that we have boiling, and we have boiling crisis, flow boiling crisis, because we have to be careful for steam generators and, of course, for nuclear power plants. This is just a levelized cost of energy, and you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the lowest one, it will be nuclear, which means that this is one of the best in terms of economical considerations, a source of energy. The top ones will be solar, photovoltaic, offshore wind, and many other things. So you can look through this in two details. coal-fired power plants, modern ones, reached supercritical pressures. Why I'm spending time on that? Because among the next generation, generation four reactors, we have supercritical water reactor concepts. In Russia, I think that Hydropress working on that, China working on that, in Canada, we have some concepts of supercritical water can do this. The basic idea that we have completely verified in industry for more than 6 years, it started in end of 50s, power plant. We don't need to invent helium turbine or to find some problems after that. It's everything proven. Just we need to replace coal with nuclear energy and supply supercritical water there. Now this is the most advanced schematic which I have found. This actually from Russia by Dr. Krupnikov from CKTI. And the basic idea, we need to get rid, to work above the saturation lines. This is bell curve. Due to this is supercritical pressure cycle, 30 megapascal, 600 degrees maximum. After that, supercritical pressure turbine or high pressure turbine, steam superheat, and after that, intermediate pressure turbines and low pressure turbines, we cross saturation line for steam, and after that, condensation. Eventually, currently, we're talking about decreasing CO2 impact from coal-fired power plants. There is and gas-fired power plants, different ideas. But we have to understand anything extra, price for electricity generated will increase, and also some other problems can be found for that. This is the most advanced cycle as of today in Tormo, which I have mentioned before. This is a Brayton gas turbine cycle, and at the outlet, it's approximately 640 degrees from outlet of the gas turbine, we have steam Rankine cycle. Combination of two giving us 55%. Due to this is what we currently looking for generation four reactors, which I will also touch at the end. Oh, I will not spend time on advantages of nuclear, concentrated reliable source, high capacity factors achievable, essentially negligible operating emissions, relatively small amount of fuel required. Nuclear power plants can supply cheap energy at night for electrical vehicles and so on. Due to this, possibly this source of energy will be the most preferential within the next 50, 100 years. Well, everybody hoped that fusion will help. But you know, when I was at school in the 60s, already Russian scientists, American scientists talking about the fusion in maybe 5, 10 years and everything will be done. Well, now 60 years passed and still we cannot get this energy to generate electricity. This is what we have currently in the world. Pressurized in total 443 reactors. I'm talking only about nuclear power reactors, which connected to grid and generate electricity. 443, the largest group pressurized water reactors. And to the right, two last columns, how many reactors possibly will be built? Possibly under question mark, more or less known plans is without this one. And this is the largest number of reactors possibly which will be built. Boiling water reactors, decreasing. I'm comparing these things what we had before the March of 2011, before the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant accident. Unfortunately, I don't want to say that boiling water reactors are something dangerous and this is something improper and so on. I cannot say that. They're really good reactors. Unfortunately, the Fukushima nuclear power plant disaster happened with older designs of boiling water reactors. And if you look at the forthcoming units, maybe only four. What this means, four never replaced 63, which is quite old. Due to this, this group of reactors, I don't want to say, but based on statistics, eventually will be vanished maybe in 30 something like years. Group number three, pressurized heavy water reactors. Also decreasing, it's slightly better, but still maybe two reactors will be built in India. They also now have possibility to design their own pressurized water reactors based on original two Kandu reactors. But still, it's not so much compared to pressurized water reactors. advanced gas-cooled reactors. They will be shut down in spite of this is the most efficient nuclear power plants in the world, up to 42%. All of them will be shut down because they are very, very old. What we might have next, I'm saying maybe for half a year, that maybe next week, but already half a year passed. In China, they should put into operation 200 megawatts electrical helium-cooled pebble bed modular reactor, which is of generation 4 and very, very interesting design. But still, nothing happened officially, I have not seen at least. No, LGRs, it's like light water graphite moderated reactors in Russia, 9 RBMKs left, and 3 EGPs. EGPs is very old reactors located, I believe, in a nuclear power plant. Where 4, 1 close, and eventually these 3 reactors also will be closed quite soon. These reactors, RBMKs, exploded in at Chernobyl nuclear power plant. They will not be built again, and they will disappear from the scene. And also, the more or less generation 4 reactors in operation, it will be liquid metal fast breeder reactors or sodium cooled fast reactors, BN600 and BN800. Only 2. China following Russia, they possibly very soon, maybe even this year, they will put 1. It's also, I think, 600 megawatts electrical. And India would like also to put a sodium-cooled reactor in operation. This data also, including 33 reactors left in Japan after the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant accident, was 54. Japan was on 3rd place. United States had around 100 reactors a number of years ago, France 58 and Japan 54, now left 33, which eventually can be connected to grid. Last year, 9 reactors, only pressurized water reactors, were in operation in Japan, but I got information that in March only 3 were in operation. And recently I have read that one, I think, new reactor started to operate. Due to this, it's like optimistic view of what we have currently in the industry. Okay, this is sector diagram, the same as in the previous table. You can see where we have light green. This is pressurized water reactors. They're taking the market, and we can do anything about it. They consider to be safer than other things. It's proven technology for many years. They can do a large one, for example, 2 EPRs. European pressurized water reactor by Arriva, they will put in operation in China, is 1660 megawatts electrical. This is huge, huge amount of that. This is most nuclear developed countries by number of reactors installed capacities. United States currently 94 reactors, France 56, China 50. China, in, this is where we have real renaissance. In 10 years after the Fukushima, they put into operation 37 reactors. No one in the world. The whole world hasn't put so many reactors in operation. China did. But currently they reached 5% of at least generated approximately at nuclear power plants. Due to this, to replace coal, which is around 65%, if you need 10%, you need 100 reactors. If you need 20%, you need 200 reactors. If you need 40%, this is very ambitious plans. What I can see, of course, we have to not forget about the cooling capabilities. And unfortunately, nuclear power reactors, like pressurized water reactors, it's only 1/3 of energy released by nuclear transferring into electricity and 2/3 into environment. Due to this, it can be some certain limit how many reactors you can put within a certain area because you need a lot of cooling water or cooling towers to cool that. And this is all countries in the world. I will not spend time on that, but green means they have plans to build. In red, they have no plans to build. Just summary, 33 countries have operating nuclear power reactors and 3 countries plan to build nuclear power reactors. In addition, 30 countries are considering, planning or starting nuclear power programs. However, 13 countries with nuclear power plants currently don't want to proceed with nuclear. This is impact of major nuclear accidents on building and putting into operation nuclear power plants. As you can see, first accident was relatively small, but still considered like a severe one, Three Mile Island in the United States. It was March 29, 1979. It has impact quite significant on United States, but not on the world. You can see that number of reactors increasing. The top one, which we reach for the whole history of nuclear, at approximately 118 nuclear power reactors built within 5 years from 85 to 89. Chernobyl happened in 86, and after that, still thermal, not thermal, but inertia, that still people building plants and putting compression, we dropping down to 36 reactors per 5 years. After that, even less, to 18 reactors, slightly recovered to 22, and after we dropping to maybe 16, slightly recovered, very close, and again Fukushima happened 2011. However, now what I can feel, we started to recover from all these three major accidents. Current level that we put into operation 40 reactors and approximately 40,000 megawatts electrical. But if you compare what was in the past, this is what we have put into operation in 1975 to 1979. Due to if another severe accident will happen, it will be a complete disaster, not only to nuclear industry, but to all our environment, because we're losing very important source of energy, reliable and large one. You just say in your work, you always have to remember about that. This is impact on the United States. As you can see, after the their accident, and of course after Chernobyl, they almost not building anything for many years. This is some general things. Top table, average, maximum, minimum installed capacities of different types of reactors. And after that, reactors, types of reactors which built in different years. You remember I have mentioned that AGRs will be closed. The last reactor was built 32 years ago. It is definitely, they will not proceed with that technology. In Russia, the latest RBMK 1000 was built in 1990, 31 years past. Due to this, this unfortunately, these two types of reactors will not be built again. This is number of reactors installed capacities. The most popular one from 900 to 999. Generation 3 plus reactors usually 1100 minimum and 1660 maximum. Due to this, higher installed capacities also moving up in this case. How long reactors operating? I pick up all reactors which were shut down from, as you can see, possibly 56. It's less than 45 years. So this is red line, 45 years. What is green means reactors which come to operating above 45 years. But vast majority were shut down before 45 years. What is interesting, recently in the United States, because they are not building reactors, so they're extending life. I don't know if it's possible to work for so long, but I think that four reactors, they extended life to 80 years. Generation 3 plus reactors like guaranteed, again, it's not yet happened, 6 years for major components. But if it will be like that, we don't know. Hopefully, yes. But this is the reality which we have. Who is doing what in the world? Well, number one will be Russia, Rosatom. To the right, Russia will build five, maybe plus three reactors inside country, Bangladesh two, Belarus one, China two, maybe two more, Egypt one, maybe three more, Finland one, Hungary maybe two, India two, plus maybe two, Iran two, and Turkey four. In total, 32. Number two will be China. It will be in China 9 plus 14 question mark. Pakistan maybe three. Romania maybe two, and it might be can do reactors. Of course, the closest one will be South Korea. Korea would like to build four reactors in South Korea and three left at the United Arab Emirates. One is already in operation. Why we have such huge difference between two countries and the rest? If you have no government support to nuclear, it will not go through. The well-known fact that even huge, monstrous companies like Westinghouse, Toshiba, Areva, smaller one, Atomic Energy Canada Limited, more or less they went through some type of bankruptcies. Due to this, one reactor is currently minimum maybe $6 billion, but usually maybe around 10. Due to this, to put such a lot of money was maybe 10, 15 years to recover them. Of course, even huge companies, they cannot do that. Only government, if our government would like to have clean air and the environment protected, they have to put money into nuclear. Because as you can... good for such things. What we can expect in the future? Red line, based on what was 5 years ago, it's approximately only 4 reactors per year, but now it will be yellow bars. Due to this, it still will be better based on last 5 years average taken here and 45 years of operation. But as you can see, still from 2030 to 2040, it does matter even if we will go double of current amount of putting reactors into operation, we will have some gap. Because we have not enough such, we lost a lot of years doing nothing due to this gap. If it will be 45 years of operation, will be definitely visible. This is generations, some explanation to that. The majority of current reactors will be generation 3. With some small improvements, slightly higher by 1-2% thermal efficiency, in increased safety, it will be generation 3+. And of course, we're looking forward for generation 4 or next generation reactors, which will be safer, more efficient, and so on. This is current level of the pressures and temperatures inside reactors. At lower level will be boiling water rate, it's approximately 7 megapascal. And this is direct cycle, can do heavy water cooled, heavy water moderator, pressure channel, horizontal channels. At outlet of can do pressure channel, actually can be up to 5-7% of steam. Pressurized water reactor sitting slightly below saturation line, because in a large pressure vessel, you cannot control the flow distribution. In pressure channel, you can do, because they have around 30 degrees lower than saturation line, not to get into boiling. And future for water-cooled reactors will be supercritical water reactors around at 25 megapascal. But currently we have no one even tested at such levels. Well, just in a short, this is typical pressurized water reactor, which currently is the most popular one. Double loop, reactor loop inside containment building. This is actually what was the problem with Fukushima Daiichi plant. It was direct cycle and a lot of water from reactor was siphoning outside the reactor. Due to this, I think there's 3 reactors actually, their core were melted. This is Rankine cycle schematic and Rankine cycle TS diagram. What you have to remember that all current water-cooled reactors, except 2 Russian LT-40S, I will tell this later, they use only saturated steam. And this is our minus. We cannot increase efficiency because we cannot overheat or superheat steam in large power reactors. Some data, I will not skip that. This is a boiling water reactor. It's direct cycle. This is what started to be the problem. Of course, a lot of improvements done, any accident required all other companies to consider the lessons learned from accident. And of course, all designs significantly improved after any accident. Some data, this is can do large, it's not pressure vessel, it's at the top atmospheric pressure, it's heavy water moderator, in horizontal channels, heavy water coolant, four pumps, four steam generators. But efficiency, unfortunately, of this rate is quite low because you have maximum inlet 11 megapascal, outlet 10. Due to this, maybe maximum they can go to 5 megapascal, but modern reactors, they're going to 7 or 7.8 as an EPR for Rankine cycle. Due to this efficiency around 32% maybe maximum. This is AGR. It's interesting, it's a concrete pressure vessel. And they built in steam generators and this carbon dioxide cooled. But unfortunately, these reactors never will be built again. But currently, is the most. What is the difference? We have superheated steam and secondary steam also superheated. Due to SPU, you're going up to 42%. This is RBMK. RBMK is similar to other reactors. Now, first of all, it's direct cycle. And also saturated steam going directly to Rankine cycle to steam turbine. BN600 sodium cooled triple loop, quite tricky reactor. Currently, only Russia has this technology in full tested and two reactors in operation. As I said, very close to China to that, and possibly India will follow up. Many other countries they would like to do that. Actually, there were some reactors like in France, Phoenix, Super Phoenix. It was a Manju reactor in Japan, but currently in operation only these two reactors as fast reactors and sodium cool. This is TS diagram, some parameters. Basically, why sodium? Sodium has the highest heat transfer coefficient. This is very attractive. Boiling water is approximately slightly lower, very close to the lower level. Can do reactor because it's very high flows. It's I think 26 kilogram per second per channel, and around 7,000 kilogram per square meter a second mass flux. Lead is inert liquid metal. Hopefully, Russia made decision to build Brest OD-300 in Seversk. I think it's Tomsk region. It will be maybe in 5-7 years. It's a unique reactor to build, and this is from generation 4. But heat transfer coefficients slightly lower, water single phase convection lower, lead bismuth, another possibility for lead cooled fast reactors around 2030. Supercritical water, this is disadvantage that it's maybe 10-25 only, helium 10, and the least. Why carbon dioxide is not so popular to build new reactors because it's the lowest heat transfer coefficient, 2-5. In terms of, let's go to schist temperature, the highest one will be AGR because carbon dioxide 650, due to this schist wall 750, you cannot use zirconium with stainless steel. Sodium cool fast reactors also 750, due to this also stainless steel. No, Magnus, it was previous type of AGRs. It's already all of them closed. And in regular reactors, it's around 300, 320, and maybe 15 degrees temperature difference between that. So this is a list of advanced boiling water reactors, means generation 3+. We don't spend on that. This is Hitachi General Electric. You can see the basic idea is really great to have in the reactor vessel everything, and just to get saturated steam out too. Another problem which I can see, usually all reactors, pressurized water reactors, can do reactors, they have shutdown rods and the regulating rods from the top, and shutdown rods dropping down by gravitation with initial push by spring, and they have magnetic lock, which is a passive safety system. For boiling water reactors, they have steam generators above, because they have to do this from below. And it was one system, or electrical or hydraulic. I think that based on lessons learned, now they're proposing a double system to increase safety. So this is a comparison generation 3 reactor, boiling water reactor with advanced boiling reactor, and you can see these things which I have to discuss. This is a lot of data from Generation 3 Plus VVR, water power reactor from Russia, Gidro Press. This is one of the new features which you can see. This is photo from Rosatom. This is core catcher. From where it came from? It came from Chernobyl nuclear power plant disaster. It was real scared that core or molten core will go through concrete foundation and it will be more disaster. This is, I am not sure if all reactors currently equipped with that, but Russian generation 3 plus V1s are they equipped. This is nice schematics from AP1000 with Singhouse reactor, which were put into operation again in China. Actually, China has almost all reactors in the world on their soil, and I think that they required to build their transfer of technologies. This is passive safety cooling system with large tank of water at the top of the containment building. So this is how it's operating. This is a first AP1000 in China. And some data, I will not spend on time. Here is a table comparison of different reactors. Usually I'm telling students, try to memorize that and you always will know what it's all about. If you're talking about pressurized water reactor, you know what is inside reactor, what is the Rankine cycle behind. Different reactors we can classify by neutron spectrum, mainly the sodium spectrum on the two sodium cool fast reactors fast, by reactor coolant and moderator. So it's water, heavy water, carbon dioxide, liquid sodium, possibly later on will be lead. No moderator, also different ones, some pros and cons, I will not spend time on that. Comparison between pressurized water reactors and boiling water reactors, they are quite similar, but of course they have some cons, means advantages and pros, advantages and cons, disadvantages in each of these designs. But this is some sort of conclusions. Now I'm going to small modular reactors in a short way. We have 106 concepts, 108 concepts, which we have found in different literature. My personal opinion, it's a lot of talking about that. It's like everybody, sorry to say, crazy about SMRs. Somebody saying that SMRs is our future. They will replace all large reactors, but I don't believe into that. Nuclear industry very regulated. Due to this, startups cannot develop any reactor, 100%. If large companies, they failed to deliver new reactors, like for example, AACL not delivered advanced CANDU reactor, it's more or less gone, but 90% completed design. Due to this, even if it were pressurized water reactors or CANDU reactors, which is known and proven, it's only very few organizations can do such things. Due to this, here is which countries, which reactors they're developing in terms of small modular reactors. This is by types of reactors as small modular, it's like a small pressurized water reactors. We have one number four, it will be a supercritical water reactor developed by Canada. What is important for small modular reactors? They should operate for a very long time before refueling. This is a small core. This two requirements, forcing the enrichment go relatively high. No, maximum what is allowed in commercial reactors by International Atomic Energy is less than 20%. Why I'm saying this? Because we have good example of Russian KLT-40S. The enrichment, if I remember correctly, 18%. Due to this, you have to have special regulations how to deal with such relatively enriched fuel, how it will be cooled because it's generating a lot of energy. Due to this, a lot of new things will be there. Plus, don't forget, smaller reactor, less efficiency of the power plant. But this is all other things. This is marine reactors, and this is how Russia went through that. They had a lot of reactors which was tested at nuclear submarines and after that ice breakers. The United States similar, but not ice breakers, but they have air carriers with more or less small modular reactors and so on. This is the way how to go. You have proven technology, but it's still military more or less application. After that, you have to do something and to transfer into civil applications. I will not spend because it's impossible to cover all of them. Let's go to Russian reactor. This is KLT-40S. It's a ship reactor. Everything in red, this is extra passive safety system added. And this took a longer time than it was expected, and definitely budget was overspent. Now, I will not spend time on discussion this. Here is photo to the left, green large cylinder reactor pressure vessel, smaller cylinders, green pumps, and gray cylinders is steam generator. It's generation 3 reactor. This is this power plant, which going to Port Pivek. It's on a barge, it's not self-propelled. This is generation 3 plus, which will be built in Yakutia, Rhythm 200M. What was done? Rosatom increased length or height of the pressure vessel, and they put steam generators inside. What they have done that? They increased thermal efficiency quite substantially compared to KLT-40S. Well, here is a comparison, and you can see that, of course, Rhythm is a slightly larger installed capacity and definitely more efficient. Now, we already discussed these things. Of course, we have to be honest and to say that current reactor generator gateways have relatively low thermal efficiencies. Risk of radiation release and production of fuel is not an environmentally friendly process. Due to this, we need to go to Gen 4 reactors. This is a driving force in thermal power industry, and nowadays in nuclear power industry, is thermal efficiency. This is what we can expect from 6th generation 4 concepts. Very high temperature reactor, helium cooled, gas cooled, fast reactor, helium cooled, supercritical water reactor, of course, water cooled, molten salt reactor, molten salt cooled, lead cooled fast reactor, lead or lead bismuth cooled, and sodium cooled fast reactor, which will be at the lower end around 40%. But this is countries which participate in Generation 4 International Forum, all basic countries. China, Japan, Russia, United States, and they discussing and moving forward with all these 6 concepts. This is some parameters of this, and this is what planned to get, but definitely all plans usually screw up, and it's extension of these plans. Which Gen 4 concept is the most popular? The most popular is very high temperature reactor with 1000 degrees helium, because together with electricity generation, you can get hydrogen, which is possibly can consider as an environmental friendly fuel. You can get process heat and many, many other things. And eventually, from all this 6 concept, only sodium cooled fast reactor are 2 of them in operation in Russia. Also, please remember that in future, a lot of supercritical fluids will be used in nuclear, as the reactor coolants water and helium, the official supercritical fluid, and also supercritical pressure cycles. For example, for Brest-OD, Russia has 2 options, 1 subcritical pressure Rankine cycle and 1 supercritical. And our publications and other things which you can use for that one. Thank you very much.
Thank you.